reserve up to 5 minutes for rebuttal. If you are the appellant and wish to reserve any time for rebuttal, if you let me know when we get started, I'm keeping the clock. I can keep your eyes from passing the time. We've read the briefs. You're ready to see what you are.
Morning, Your Honors. I'd like to divide 11 and 4, if I may. May it please the court, my name is Mark Ludwig. I'm here on behalf of Mr. and Mrs. Marks. They were referred to me by their very competent trial attorney, Mr. Haley. It's a privilege to have been so referred. The question presented in this case was the bank entitled to a summary judgment determining that the mortgage it had attached to the wife's undivided half interest? The answer is the bank was not so entitled. That on this record, the wife's one-half interest is not summarily encumbered, and this court should reverse and remand proceedings consistent with its decision. I'm sure we all say this to you every time, but this case does have some very singular facts that somewhat separated from the, quote, normal mortgage case. Mr. Marks's affidavit pointed out in opposing summary judgment that throughout this, he has pretty much acted alone. That Mrs. Marks wasn't involved in negotiations and, as we later explained, wasn't involved in very many signatures other than one that said, I'm only encumbering my dower interest. Her signature is on the mortgage prepared by the bank with that endorsement, and that's how she signed, releasing her dower rights only. She never signed the note twice. She never signed the note. The first refinancing that came out of bankruptcy court, the second refinancing after they had filed a first foreclosure case, which, by the way, they had not initially disclosed to the trial court that they'd done. Does that automatically mean a win? No, it doesn't, but it does say something about the equity that the bank brought to show the court.
The counsel, there was just the one time the mortgage was signed, but there were two notes, both of which were only signed by Mr. Marks.
Correct.
And
it happened once out of bankruptcy and then once in the first foreclosure. The first refinancing, undisputed, that it was due to the husband's business interests, and the bankruptcy was made necessary because of that. That was with First Financial, which then assigned to this bank. This bank then files a foreclosure, and as part of that first foreclosure action, asks for reformation, saying, oops, the wife should have been on this mortgage in that first foreclosure action. However, it doesn't pursue that claim. It resolves by refinancing again, it resolves, again not asking that she sign any note, and specifically, in the terms of its refinancing, approving and affirming all prior agreements. So it particularly, it had a second chance to catch what it said is a mistake, and this chance was on its own. It was it, not assuming First Financial's mistakes. Again, it sought reformation then and didn't get it. There was a counterclaim in that case that was not dismissed, but we've not pounded the table over that issue as to whether the first case was really properly totally dismissed. The bank's affidavit in this case says, I'm the North Star representative, but never says, we meant to attach to the entire interests. Never says, there was a mutual mistake when we prepared the mortgage. And in fact, avers that when we file a foreclosure, we have to follow federal law and give notice to everyone who's responsible on the mortgage. Then, and says, here's our letter attached, we did that. The letter attached shows they only sent it to Roger Marks, not to Mr. and Mrs. Marks. So by their own admission, in their motion, they didn't follow federal law as the necessary notice to the bankruptcy. The entry in this case, who are we kidding? We're here arguing summary judgment to this court like it's de novo. Because the entry in this case says it's granted, quote, on the grounds set forth in plaintiff's motion. The bank had five theories as to why it says it was in order. And in the normal case, there's basically only one theory. Hey, you didn't pay. Okay, you go ahead and sign the entry. In this case, the bank says, well, there's five theories why we should be able to stick the wife. And in doing that, it says, well, we don't cite any case to this court about it should win on any one of the five theories. And in the trial court, it said in a reply brief, well, we meet the elements of each of the five theories, and then said, and I'm not one to criticize how one misuses the language often, but we meet the elements of each of the cases, either of which justifies winning. Now, again, I don't think they meet any of the five theories. But in their reply brief, they said we meet all five.
When you get a foreclosure injury and you have multiple parties that have an interest in the property on which you wish to foreclose, do you need to set out what portion of what is happening is attaching to what interest in order to get summary judgment? In other words, the theories go to whether or not their interest is in priority to her interest, right? Her interest. They could have gotten foreclosure.
Yeah. Only because I don't have the real estate experience your Honor does, I wouldn't use the word priority as the issue. I've always used this question whether or not it even attaches to her interest. Okay? So, and if that's the same as priority, I bow to your Honor's judgment. But what I'm basically saying is, yeah, the issue is, did it even attach? And they said it does because of these five theories. The trial court did not indicate which or all of the theories it was accepting as the reason it attached. For example, that's why we're arguing five theories to you, not sure which one or all five or three of the five. Or why are we doing that again? Because the trial court, in a multiple theory case, didn't say something to give us some guides. Now, you're not bound by her decision, and in point of fact, you can review. You're reviewing de novo, but that doesn't mean that you're recently not having to do initial summary judgment work. That's what's being shoved on you, in a sense. For example, one of the theories is reformation. They say we were entitled to judgment on the basis of reformation. They twice prepared a judgment entry that doesn't order reformation. It doesn't say a word about reformation in it. In fact, and then they cite the Countrywide case, a 10th District case, where the 10th District reversed a trial court that ordered reformation. How can you say I'm entitled to reformation, prepare the judgment entry, and not order the things reformed? The next one was unjust enrichment. They cite a case called Hambleton, where there was a confidential relationship and a theft of business. There's no allegation here that there was any confidential relationship between all these parties, and I'm sure the bank feels through its own errors, its chance to have a lien against the wife has been stolen from it, but it's not a theft. So there's unjust enrichment gone down the drain. Equitable subrogation is akin to an unjust enrichment, and it's applied generally where there are fraud and mutual mistakes. In the Calhoun-Hendry case they cited in paragraph 14, there was an affidavit where the parties agreed that they intended this to take place. Well, equitable subrogation has to take place. They agreed that they meant that to be. Mrs. Marks has never said that she agreed that her interest would be subjected. From her standpoint, that's why she went to bankruptcy and got out. And part of the bankruptcy proceeds paid $10,000 or $20,000, counsel knows the number, of unsecured creditors. There was a benefit that went and got that property discharged. Some of the money went to pay unsecured creditors. There's a constructive trust claim. They cite the Gable case where the parties agreed there was an implied trust. These parties have not agreed to any implied trust from which then a constructive trust is imposed. They cite the theory of resulting trust and cite the Lips case. Husband's paramour forges wife's name to a purchase and a mortgage. Wife decides not to pursue her divorce case and comes into court and says, oh, I should have that property free and clear of the mortgage. Court says, no, you can disclaim your interest in the property, okay, or you can take the property subject to the interest. Everybody knew you were supposed to be stuck. That's why she forged your name. If you want to take the benefit of the property, the brand new property just purchased, then you got to take the mortgage. If you don't want to take the brand new property just purchased, just disclaim it. I don't know what she ultimately did, but she didn't get the property free and clear. It's very hard to tell Mrs. Marks that this thing has been through a bankruptcy refinancing, a first foreclosure, a refinancing there. You never signed the note, and you only signed the mortgage the way they told you to. And oh, by the way, it was a mutual mistake that we ought to win on. If this case had gone to trial, and the fact finder had found certain theories, we probably might not be standing here. But this is a summary judgment case, and the question is, does equity require the relief?
Can you just now reach that 4 minutes?
I will reserve the time. Thank you, Your Honors.
Thank you.
Sorry, I couldn't find my glasses. I have my wife's glasses. I apologize. But at this age, I can't see without them. Let me know when you want me to commence.
Go right ahead.
Okay. Thank you. I'm not quite the order that the appellant's attorney is. I apologize. But in any event, the reason why we're here on summary judgment and why this is appropriate for summary judgment, one of the many reasons, is that no 56C evidence was submitted whatsoever in opposition of all of our certified copies, deposition, affidavit, and other 56C evidence. The most telling fact in this is that Mrs. Marks herself did not file an affidavit, did not sign an affidavit, and isn't disputing any of this. It's her husband trying to say somehow what she intended. Mrs. Marks isn't disputing that she intended the mortgage to attach to her property. In fact, if she did, I think she'd be purging herself, because if we go to the bankruptcy documents where the debtors, both Marks, their attorney, filed the motion with the court requesting permission to refinance with First Franklin, and the First Franklin had the first mortgage, and all their prior debts are going to be paid by First Franklin, and that was filed on behalf of both Kathy and Roger Marks.
And are those bankruptcy records part of the record?
Absolutely. Certified copies of the bankruptcy records are attached to the summary judgment motion.
And did the bank seek any judgment against her with respect to the note that she did?
No, because the note is only signed by Mr. Marks, which is common. And all of the equities favor the bank in this case. Counsel is saying that $22,000 went to satisfy unsecured debts. Well, Your Honors, there were over $1 million of unsecured debts. Nearly 900,000 of those debts also attached to Kathy Marks' property. So the Markses and Kathy Marks got rid of $1 million worth of unsecured debt for $22,000. And there's no way in the world that the trustee or anybody else is going to let them walk out with a free half interest in a $455,000 house. Obviously, there could be no way, nobody intended that.
Does anyone think it matters? I mean, maybe the trial court addressed this, the fact that this is an undivided one-half interest?
No, I don't think that is an issue one bit, Your Honor.
So if you had not named Kathy Marks in the foreclosure case, and there, let's assume she didn't sign the mortgage out of it either, what would be the end result of this foreclosure action?
Well, if we did not name her, such as any interest that we didn't name, their interest would stay and everyone that was named would be washed out, just like if you don't include a lien holder and you file a foreclosure, you eliminated all the senior liens and whoever you didn't name moves up. And I think the reason why the court entered the judgment entry on all five grounds is we have all the elements of all five grounds. There's no issue. We've met every element. My brief in the Court of Appeals sets forth how we meet every element. My summary judgment motion meets every element. And the elements are all pretty straightforward and pretty simple. But most telling is are the facts, Your Honor. The bankruptcy records, most of all, were filed on behalf of Kathy and Roger Marks, requesting the court this relief to allow First Franklin to refinance. And it specifically says they want to refinance so they can keep their home. So First Franklin provides the funds so the Marks can keep their home.
Isn't that a finding of fact?
Well, no, that's what they...
Why they want to refinance?
That's what they said in their motion, Your Honor. If you go to the Marks' motion, which is attached to our summary judgment brief, certified copy, they specifically state that they are requesting the ability to refinance and get approval to refinance with First Franklin so they can keep their home. So Kathy Marks was well aware of the benefit that First Franklin was conferring upon them. Now, as I stated before, they also satisfied a tremendous amount of debt in the bankruptcy court. And if you look at the home value, the Marks in the bankruptcy petition valued the home, that's Roger and Kathy Marks, they both signed it, they valued the home at $455,000. The auditor also has it valued at $455,000, and the amount of the mortgage is $444,000. Now, no bank in the world is going to loan $444,000 on a $455,000 house in exchange for a secured half interest. Pursuant to the Schultz case, which we attached, you can make inferences from the totality of the facts surrounding a loan to see what the true intention was. If we look to the Marks, Kathy Marks' deposition, at no point she didn't know what dower meant. She didn't request the mortgage to have the dower language on there. She admitted to signing the truth in lending statement. And she admitted in deposition that she was not told that the mortgage did not attach or have interest in the property. And again, she filed no affidavit or any evidence contradicting that of the bank. Now, the Ohio courts have long recognized that there are mistakes made in documents, mortgages, and deeds, and they provide relief under numerous documents of widely accepted law in Ohio, to wit, everything we included, unjust enrichment, constructive trust, resulting trust, equitable subrogation, and reformation. And we have the elements, and undisputed facts for the elements of each of these five theories of law. And again, there is no evidence submitted opposing anything. Mr. Marks is somehow trying to testify on behalf of Kathy Marks, but we have nothing from Kathy Marks. And to her credit, she's not fighting this. Now, Mr. Marks, he eliminated, well, both of them, over $1 million of debt while only repaying $22,000. And he seems to still claim that Kathy's imprint should be unencumbered, but to her credit, she's not. In the appellate brief, the appellant also claims that the condition precedent of the notice of acceleration was not properly given. Well, this was not raised in the trial court. It can't be raised in the Court of Appeals. However, it's still a non-issue because that is not a federal law or any law requirement. That is contractual. And if you look at the note says that only the borrower is required to receive notice of acceleration. And paragraph 22 of the mortgage also only requires a borrower to receive the notification. And only Roger Marks was a borrower under the note. And in fact, if you look at the Marks summary judgment brief, they argue vociferously that Kathy Marks is not the borrower. So she wasn't entitled to the notice, even had this been raised. But we didn't have a chance to provide the notice that we would have given her because it wasn't raised. So that may have been given, but we didn't provide that because the argument wasn't raised at any point before the Court of Appeals. Just to address a few of the appellant's arguments, they claim the loan modification was another opportunity for the bank to somehow make her liable on this. Well, the loan modification is not a new document. It specifically says it amends and supplements the agreement. All it does is lower the interest rate to 2,000. So the modification, which appellant is somehow trying to use against the plaintiff bank, again, that's a bank trying to help them. They lower their interest rate when they were struggling down to 2%, and now they're trying to use this document against them. Much like the bank tried to keep them in their home, they allowed them to stay in their home with their loan, they lowered the modification, they lowered the interest rate with the modification. At every turn, First Franklin's trying to help these people, and in no way can First Franklin be, and their successor, U.S. Bank, be portrayed as the bad guy with the unclean hands here. They were consistently trying to help the Marks at every turn. And in fact, the last so many years, they've been the only ones paying the property taxes and the insurance on it. So, okay, I'm just going to start getting really repetitive if I continue on here. Is there any more questions by the panel?
Seeing none.
Thank you.
Mr. Kennedy?
We are not overwhelmed by the bank's kindness. The magic words here, if you will, are summary judgment and equity. If this court feels that summary judgment was appropriate on this state of the record and that equity was done or will be done by summarily attaching to her interest, this court will so say. I love the alliteration of Mrs. Marks didn't do anything in this case. Oh, by the way, in her deposition she said. Well, I thought the deposition testimony was filed as part of the record. She's doing something there. Mrs. Marks is all engineered by her husband. There's nothing in the record that supports that. Mr. Marks has been taking the lead on this, if you will, because Mr. Marks is the one that got them into this. He's the one that negotiated the deal. He's the one that said, you know, when the papers aren't signed by her as encumbering her interest, that's what makes it a great deal. Yes, it's a good deal. Okay, it's a bad deal for the bank. It's the one the bank's made. The fundamental premise here is there an adequate remedy. This bank is now represented by the insurance carrier who can make them whole with monetary sums for their errors. There is an adequate remedy for the bank to recover. Finally, in support of the idea of why are we arguing, at least we know the answer now to that, by the way. We've just heard that all five theories support what they've done. That's what they're saying. The position in this court is all five theories support what they've done. Now, if that's the case, and one of them falls, then it all falls by their own shooting of one of their toes. The foot is injured. And here we are with the Reformation. They twice prepare a deed, a summary judgment decree, that doesn't reform the instruments. This court has recently said in January of this year, and I think the author was kind in not expressing the exasperation this court must feel, but in our supplemental authority of the Copeland CRW case, this court says, we're getting, basically says at paragraphs 11 and 12, we're getting tired of being the court of original determination of summary judgment. While we review a judge de novo and we afford no deference, we can't review an award in a case, complex case that one was, it had a couple of theories. It had a couple of theories. We can't review an award when the trial court's judgment provides no indication of what it actually decided. This entry does say, oh, I decide there's foreclosure and the wife's interest is attached. Oh, really, on what theory? What theory did the trial court find this on that this court is reviewing?
Didn't the order, in effect, say on all theories?
It doesn't.
Well, it says...
For the reasons set forth in his motion.
For the reasons of... All of their reasons are right. And
that reading is...
Isn't that a possible reading?
That is a possible reading, and it's also a reading which... In this kind of case, this court shouldn't have to do. All right? Thank you, Your Honors.
Thank you. Thank you both for your presentations this morning. The court will take the matter under advisement. We will issue a written decision, which will be known on both sides, or all sides, to this appeal, and also be posted on the Ohio Supreme Court website. Thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you very much, Your Honor.